When we talk about bioluminescence, you might be thinking about a couple of things depending on which part of the world you live in. Some might be thinking about firefly, and some might be thinking about the jellyfishes that you saw in an aquarium nearby. Now, firefly, of course, is an excellent example for bioluminescence, but jellyfish, although it shows bioluminescence, what you see in the aquarium is nothing but fluorescence produced by the light above the tank. Now, when the light shines off these little organisms, fluorescent proteins within their cells will light up, and that's what you see. Now, fluorescence is significantly different from bioluminescence because bioluminescence involves a chemical reaction. Whereas in the case of fluorescence, the fluorescent substance will absorb certain wavelength of light and then emit a different wavelength. And usually this emitted light is in the visible spectrum so that we can see it using our naked eye. Now, fluorescence is very important to biological research because most of the things that we deal with in biology are really, really tiny. The only way to visualize them are by using some kind of molecule that can light up. For example, in the case of DNA, we use certain dyes that bind to DNA. For example, DAPI or ethidium bromide, when you shine laser or UV on them, these molecules will fluoresce so that you know where the DNA is. If you want to know certain proteins, you want to track where the proteins are produced and where are they going, you tag them with the fluorescent protein molecules, which will tell you where the proteins are produced and where they are active. Now, you can compare bioluminescence more closer to a glow stick. As you know, a glow stick is a two-chamber tube. It has a flexible outer chamber and a brittle inner chamber, and these two chambers carry unique chemicals. When you bend the glow stick, the inner compartment breaks and the chemicals will mix together, generating light. When it comes to living organisms, the molecules that are required for generating light are situated within the same compartment. For example, here there is an enzyme that's required for generating bioluminescence called luciferase, and the substrate of this enzyme is called luciferin. Now, although they are present in the same compartment of the cell, the luciferin and luciferate cannot interact with each other because under normal conditions, the active site of luciferase is not accessible to luciferin. But when conditions change and there are certain ions like magnesium, calcium, and hydrogen present in the cellular matrix, these ions can bind to the protein luciferase, thereby making some structural changes to the protein, bringing out the active site and making it accessible to the substrate luciferin. Once it attaches to the active site, the luciferin gets oxidized in presence of oxygen, generating light. Now, in this case, the ions present in the cell acts as a switch so that the organisms can precisely control when to generate light or not. Now, living organisms use bioluminescence for multiple purposes. Some use it to attract mate, defend of predators, etc. For example, here is a squid. It's in fear of being eaten by this large fish, and it will light up right away to try to scare the predator. An interesting example is the anglerfish here, which has a little bioluminescent bait suspended right above its mouth. And if a school of fish gets attracted to that bait, they will become a part of anglerfish's dinner. Now, what's the evolutionary significance of bioluminescence? A very interesting observation is that 98% of the organisms that show bioluminescence live in marine conditions, underwater, where light is naturally very poor. So bioluminescence forms a very important mechanism for the survival of these organisms in such dark environment. It allows them to communicate easily at long distances, just like how important is it to turn on your headlights at night. So those who can make light at their will takes a huge advantage over everyone else underwater.